Hi there, Lindsay here, the Frugal Crafter. Today we're going to make this fun mixed media card, and we're using some stamps from the company Polka Doodles. These stamps came from topflightstamps.com. They're our sponsor, and they go all around the world and find the coolest stamps to bring back to us here in the United States. Polka Doodles is a UK company, and their images are so adorable. We're going to be doing a lot of gel printing in this video, and I'm going to be working in layers. And the first layer I'm going to be putting on my gel plate is some alcohol ink. Now, I was going to draw some designs with a marker, but they really weren't sticking that well. So what I ended up doing was putting some stencils in the wet ink and making some impressions. And then I decided to go ahead and get my alcohol inks in tubes, or in bottles rather. So you can use either, it doesn't matter. I thought it would be fun to kind of fill in some of the shapes in the stencil with my markers just to be able to control the colors a little bit, but you can use either. I really like the versatility of this technique, and the reason I like to put the alcohol ink down first is that it dries quickly. So you can mess with this, get it just the way you want it, then you can add layers on top, and it's not going to mess up the alcohol ink down below. It's not going to reactivate it or smear it or anything. So doing this type of technique I really love because it leads to very interesting prints. So I'm using some different drops of ink here. You can kind of see how those first bits I colored kind of beaded up, except for the areas that I colored in with the stencil. So we're just giving a bunch of different colors and textures, and that's pretty much what we're doing in this layer. What I'm using here to apply my alcohol inks is a homemade tool. Basically what I did was I took one of my kids' old ABC blocks, wooden blocks, and I cut some craft store white felt to about 1 inch squares. So you can get tons of them from a couple sheets of cheap felt when it goes on sale. And then I just keep a baggie of those and I stick them on the block. I put Velcro on the block, the hook side, so it just grabs off those felt, and it works like the best ink applicator. But you know, it costs pennies. So I decided to go back in with the stencils on the wet ink, and that way it just kind of smushes the ink around and leaves a very subtle pattern. And that's basically what I wanted. And to keep it from getting all over my hands, I just rolled over this with a brayer to really press those stencils in. You can take as much time as you want with this, or you can do it pretty quickly. I'm also taking some plastic canvas and just pressing in some of the openings to give it a little bit more texture. It really doesn't matter what you have for stencil patterns. Use anything. Use whatever you have. Use an onion bag or a piece of embossed paper, or you know, anything to make that texture in there. It doesn't have to be anything store-bought or special. Now what I'm doing is adding a specific design here. I'm adding some stars, and I'm using sponges and pastel. These are pan pastels, which can be a little bit pricey if you don't have them already, but good news, you can go ahead and use any cheap eyeshadow that you might already have on hand. I guess you could use expensive eyeshadow too, but the cheap eyeshadow work just as well. So any sort of chalks you have are going to be fine. Just apply it with a sponge and you can put it through the stencils really easily. The nice thing about pan pastels or cheap eyeshadow is that it's softer. So with the sponge, it comes up a lot easier versus trying to do this with a pastel stick, which would be a little firmer. Then what you want to do is squeeze out a light color of acrylic paint onto a scrap. And I'm just working on I've got a scrap of cardstock that it was an old gel print that I wanted to add some texture to. And then I press my paper down there and I set it aside to dry. So that gel print is off drying on the corner of my table. In the meantime, I took a 5x7 card and just taped it down to my craft mat so I could work on it. And I'm going to use a combination of distress oxide ink pads and sprays. And I got to tell you, guys, the pads are so awesome. I have not found the sprays to be all that valuable in my craft room. I am still using them and trying to justify the crazy amount of them I bought, but I'm finding the distress oxide pads are a much better investment. And if you buy the reinkers, honestly, I don't think there's any difference taking the reinkers with some water in a spray bottle versus buying the sprays. So my advice would be, if you really love the distress oxide pads, get the pads and reinkers and then make your own sprays in like mini misters or something small so you don't have to have so much of them around. And that works so just as well. I'm kind of regretting the fact that I bought all those distress oxide sprays, but I'm going to be using them on this card so you can see, you know, how they work and whatnot, but I don't think they compare in versatility to the pad. So if you were one of those folks trying to decide what to get, because now they're both out and you haven't taken the plunge yet, I highly recommend the pads. I'm just kind of not so in love with the sprays. And I know I haven't done a full review because I feel like I need to use them for more things, and I really want to like them because I spent so much darn money on them, but you know, I'm not loving them yet. So I just want to give you guys this, the distress oxide spray update for those of you who have been waiting with bated breath for a review on those. Then I decided I would give it a little bit of spray Didn't really need to. I mean, I had the ink pad right there, but, you know, trying to justify the sprays again. And that's the other thing. When you do the sprays, I find they feather a little bit, like when you spray over a stencil versus like using the ink pad and a sponge over a stencil. I mean, that's not their fault. That's just kind of the nature of sprays, but, you know, that's how it is. That's where I'm at right now with the sprays. Probably more information than you wanted. But basically what you want to do here is just make something interesting. And the cool thing about the distress oxide products, whether it be the sprays or the ink pads, is that you can spray it with water, or you can stamp over it with water, you can stencil over it and like spray water through a stencil, and you can just get some really cool lighter effects as the white pigment kind of pulls up to the surface or it oxidizes. You can do this with the distress ink pads and get a similar effect. The distress ink pads, the regular ones, are a little bit more vibrant. They're a little bit brighter. Actually, I don't know. I like the oxides better than the regular distress ink pads, but you'll get a good effect. And I got to tell you, before I had that many distress oxide ink pads, I was mixing them with the distress inks. I was using both in the same project and it worked really well. I didn't want to waste all of this. I did press some onto a piece of cardstock before I totally cleaned my stencil. But whenever I'm doing if I'm using ink on a stencil, I do clean them. With acrylic paint, I usually don't bother wiping them off, but I do with, when I'm using an ink, like a distress ink or an ink spray, just because they will transfer onto my next project if I'm not careful, and I don't want to risk ruining another project. Now, when you let your ink, your gel print dry on your gel pad, you get a really awesome textured background. Isn't that cool? Now, I just want to warn you, that's great if you have the Jelly Arts plate or if you have the gel press plate. That technique works great. If you have the Stampendous Creative Palette, don't let it dry fully. You can let it sit there for like 10 minutes max and then peel off the paper. Otherwise, it's going to stick too firmly to your plate and it's going to rip. So I just wanted to make that known because I tried it with both to see if the technique would work with both. And I did find with the Creative Palette by Stampendous, you got to remove that paper while it's still wet or it's going to tear. And use cardstock for that technique because it lighter paper might rip. Now I'm just adding some of the texture stamps from Polka Doodles. I really thought those stamp sets went well together. Actually, I think this texture set would go with pretty much any of their stamp set, but I thought that with the Building Houses stamp set was just really, really cool together because I just felt like you could add texture to the shapes in the set where you can build houses. You could add textures to the background. I like to do this where I take black ink and I stamp all around the edges and make a cool frame. I just think it makes it look like I have an extra layer on my card base and makes it kind of interesting. Now, a quick tip here, when you're working on cardstock, especially, it's a little bit more finicky and it will want to tear up under your tape. So if you heat that with your heat tool before you remove the tape, it helps tremendously on that masking tape, not ruining your cardstock or not pilling or picking up any of the fibers of the paper. So there's a tip. So I'm going to do some collaging here. So what I did was I stamped the different parts and pieces of the house stamps onto my gel print that I did. And I just used a VersaFine ink and I am going to heat emboss it. But if I could find my stays-on ink pad, I probably gave it away because I really don't like using stays-on ink very much, but I couldn't find my black stays-on pad. That's if you use that, you wouldn't have to heat emboss it. But using a pigment ink, if I didn't heat emboss it on top of that acrylic paint, there's no way it would have dried. So that's why I'm doing that. Archival ink doesn't dry that great on top of a sealed surface either. So unless you have stays on, you really want to use some embossing powder and heat set it. Plus, it gives you a neat texture, so there's really no reason not to. I didn't really have a really light color, but I love this scrap paper that I used as my kind of brayering acrylic paint palette so much that I decided to stamp some clouds out of that and also do a few more house pieces so I can mix and match. I kind of wish that I had a little more variety in my colors in my gel print to cut those pieces from because they were all very similar. You can alter that a bit with paint. I'm going to show you that with some paint pens in a bit. But I kind of wish I had a little more variety in colors when I started off. And I totally could have because I had all those markers and I had all those alcohol inks. So I just thought I'd tell you that in case you want to change it a little bit. Now, you can also hand draw some houses. Just use like a permanent marker, like a black Sharpie or something. And that will work fine. And then you can stamp on some of these cool tiny embellishments that come in that Polka Doodle stamp set. There's funky hearts and doodads and windows and doors and shapes, and it's just kind of fun. Now, I thought I had like half of a roof. It was actually a chimney that I stamped there, and then I hand drew the rest of it. If you see on the top of that house that I hand drawed, it didn't occur to me that was a chimney at first. Sometimes you get to play with a stamp set before you realize all it can do. In fact, I think that's usually the case. And then I just arranged everything on my paper to decide how I wanted to stick it down. You can use whatever reliable glue you like. I actually recycled my Tombow glue bottle here, and I put matte Mod Podge in it, and it works great. I like the Tombow glues too, but I really love that applicator and I hate to waste stuff, so I just refill it from my gallon of Mod Podge and it works fabulously. And I like the matte because if it squeezes out the edges, you don't see the shiny spot or get that kind of snail trail. But it doesn't grab really quickly, so once you've got everything glued down, you will want to put like a clear stamping block on top of it until it dries. So it's all dried, and what I'm doing here is using some acrylic paint pens to color in some of the designs that are on the houses. I think that really adds a lot, especially if you didn't have a lot of variety in your prints. Now, that's a great opportunity to use scraps of patterned paper that you have. You could even stamp on fabric with a fabric ink, and you could collage that way and get some different textures there. You could use any of your old gel prints. Really, the sky's the limit. Have fun with the supplies you have on hand, and I love projects that use up leftovers because it just looks, it looks so unique. Nobody's going to have a card exactly like yours. Now, I did want a little bit more a contrast between the buildings and the background because I used a lot of the same colors, even though I used different products. I had a lot of the same colors going on. So what I'm doing here is using my Ink Tense watercolor pencils, or they're a water-soluble ink, actually. I'm using a dark blue and a charcoal black, I think. And I just used a water brush to spread it out. Now, you do have to be careful doing that on top of the Distress Oxide. You get kind of like a little bit of a cauliflower bloom where it wants to lift the Distress Oxides underneath. But I just figure it's kind of smoggy, and it works with my row of houses there. You can find these stamps at our sponsor, topflightstamps.com. I thank you so much for watching. Please give me a thumbs up before you go. And until next time, happy crafting. Thank you.